Hello everybody. Well, my presentation, it's about bilingualism and bilingual education here in Pasto. As you probably know, like 10 years ago, this term bilingualism started to develop in Colombia, and the idea was to get Colombia bilingual. It was a project that involved second language teaching more deeply, and the idea was like that in 10 years, citizens will be able to communicate in a second language, in this case, English. This program was developed by the Ministry of National Education, and the idea was that it had some conditions and it had some requirements for institutions to develop this project. However, after some years, the researchers, teachers, policymakers realized that the program was kind of pretentious and the goals were not achieved. This presentation explains the conditions of a private university in Colombia, the Universidad Cooperativa de Colombia, the conditions in which we work, the type of English and the type of English program we develop here, and why this bilingualism has not been achieved in Pasto, here in Colombia. Basically, it's about the conditions, this paper and this presentation, it's about the conditions that we have in Pasto, the problems that we have to develop this bilingual program, and what should we do to get this type of education. The UCC intends that, as in most Colombian universities, intends that its their students develop some degree of proficiency in second language, and the goals or the program is attached to the Common European Framework. I have mentioned this before, but here in the Universidad Cooperativa we work with a blended methodology, 3 hours a week in the classroom and 3 hours independent work in the virtual platform. We don't have a textbook, and we have 28 students per classroom, and our students are students from public schools and from small towns. This is the audience that we have. What are the problems that we normally face in the university, in the classroom? We have personality issues, motivation and attitudes, attributions, time limitation, lack of authentic material, poor or non-outside practice, illiteracy, multi-skilled students, and language minorities. I'm going to explain all of this in detail now. The personality issues. Students have low self-esteem and low sense of self-efficacy. Sometimes students feel that they were not born for English. English is not for them, and this is the starting point of the classes. When students get to the first semester, they say that English is not for them, and they have that in mind, that they are not going to succeed in learning English. The motivation. Students see English as an extra and important subject. I think this is the normal reality in Colombian universities, in some Colombian universities. Students don't care about English, and for them English is just like the extra subject that they are forced to take. Attributions. We have seen this theory and how this affects students. We here in the Universidad Cooperativa, we are trying to carry out a survey to determine the expectations and the experiences regarding English. The idea is to fight against these attributions. Sometimes students feel that English is not for them because of the teacher they had at school. So we are trying to carry out a survey to see what they think, their positive and their negative aspects regarding English. Time limitations. I want to read this quote. 1 or 2 hours a week, even for 7 or 8 hours, will not produce very advanced second language speakers, like when I'm speaking. Unfortunately, this is the time that we have in most universities, 2 or 3 hours. As I said before, we have in the Universidad Cooperativa, we have 3 hours a week. which unfortunately it's every week that we teach one class and then we stop the topic. We see in 8 days, sometimes the students don't pay too much attention to English assignments or English homework, so that is another problem. Poor outside practice. One of the biggest disadvantages of small cities is the few chances learners have to practice their L2. If you take Bogota, Medellin, or Cali, you might have or you might find native speakers, and you have the chance to practice with those people. Even you can do some outside practice. Unfortunately, in cities like Pasto, the opportunities to find native speakers is very limited, and it's difficult to have these chances to practice outside the classroom. Language minorities. The UCC has opened its doors to students from different regions, such as Putumayo, Tumaco, Picante, Mayama, and even some Ecuadorian cities. Since people from Putumayo or from small towns are coming, they belong to language minorities, sometimes to indigenous communities. They struggle more than students from urban areas. They struggle more with English. The university policy is that they are not bilingual. They speak Spanish, but we kind of neglect their language, their minority language. This is something that must be addressed if we want to achieve some kind of respect for languages. Do UCC teachers know about bilingualism? Are they aware of what bilingualism means? In order to perform this project, I carried out a survey among my colleagues, among the teachers, and I asked them if they understood the term bilingualism. I asked them if they knew about bilingualism. I asked them a series of questions. This is the survey. I'm going to send it to your email, guys, so you can check it better. There were 5 questions. In a few words, provide a definition for bilingualism. What are the characteristics of a bilingual person? Do you consider yourself a bilingual person, yes or no, and why? Rights and conditions that must be provided in order to develop a bilingual program in Pasto. What could be some advantages and disadvantages of applying a bilingual program in Pasto? And then to rate from 5, excellent, to 1, deficient, the current conditions in Pasto in order to develop a bilingual program. They were teachers' training, materials, seminars and conferences, appropriate time, enough exposure to the L2, student motivation, opportunities for students to practice the L2 outside the classroom. I applied this survey to my colleagues, and the results were the following. In a few words, provide a definition for bilingualism. Most of them, or I would say all of them, agree that bilingualism is the ability to speak 2 languages fluently and use them interchangeably, to use them in different communicative situations. What are the main characteristics of a bilingual person? Ability to listen, read, write, and speak 2 languages. Masters aspect of communicative competence, understand social and cultural characteristics of the language. Knows the language in terms of grammar functions and uses in communicative situations. Do you consider yourself bilingual? Yes, no, or why, and why? The one says yes, because I can use English and Spanish properly. Yes, because I dominate English and Spanish. No, because my social environment does not require from me to use this language. This teacher thinks that in order to be bilingual, the environment needs to force you to use the language, so you can use English and Spanish. Rights and conditions that must be provided in order to develop a bilingual program in Pasto. Qualified teachers, a good learning environment, a clear curriculum, enough time to practice, a well-designed program, and enough materials. You can see that some of these conditions that are written here are basically the conditions that we don't have, or that we are not providing our students. What could be some advantages and disadvantages of applying a bilingual program in Pasto? It is a link between students and a new world. is a possibility to apply to scholarships, increase tourism, enrich our cultures, and one of the disadvantages was that not everybody will be ready to face the demands of a bilingual program. Why not? Because we are sometimes thinking about students who live in the city. But as I mentioned, we have students from towns, from villages. They have not the same possibility, or their English has not been the same, their English training has not been the same than our city kids, our city students. I interviewed some of my colleagues. These videos, again, I'm going to send you to you guys, because it doesn't make sense to show them here because of the audio problems. Probably you may not listen to them well. I interviewed two of my colleagues. Besides the survey, I interviewed them and I asked them the same questions. Besides, I asked them if they thought that one day Colombia might be a bilingual country. They both agreed that it wouldn't be possible under the current conditions. If we don't change these conditions, we are not going to be a bilingual program. And besides, one of them said that the difference between among cities, it's enormous. The conditions that you find in the capital city, it's completely different to the conditions that you find here in Pasto. So if we want to be a bilingual country, we have to try to have the equal conditions or the similar characteristics in some cities. Then this is the question: why are we bilingual yet? First, I would say, as I have mentioned, the conditions that we have for becoming a bilingual country are not the appropriate ones. We think that all of our students are the same. We tend to see our students as unique and similar in the same conditions, but they have different characteristics. Some of them, we normally tell our students that English is important, for them it's not, and for them it is just a waste of time. In general, in Colombia, there is a lack of planning and contextualization of the program. If you think that the framework, the Common European Framework, was adapted, and sometimes it was adopted the same way. But the characteristics that you might find in Europe are very different to the characteristics that we find here in Colombia. It is necessary to widen the focus of the program. We now, in order to be bilingual, we are required to learn English as the target language. But we neglect French, German, Italian, other languages that are being taught at universities. There are some studies that show that these languages are also taught at universities. Pretentious goals, this is another one. We want to achieve B1 in universities, B1 level according to the Common European Framework. This is, I would say, under these conditions, this is very difficult. My students, when they graduate, and they take this proficiency test, they show like 80% they are in A2 because they don't have the conditions, they don't have the time or the materials to develop these goals. Reconsider the adoption of the Common European Framework as reference for foreign language teaching. I would suggest to consider another studies or some other conditions to measure our proficiency. If we just consider the Common European Framework, we are going too far, and I think that affects somehow our progress. What should be done, especially here at the UCC, at the Universidad Cooperativa? This is something that must be done before achieving or reaching this B1 level. Administrators need to rethink the university's syllabus, and the English program itself. Sometimes the English program, I have been working here for 4 years now, and I see that there is no connection between the first level and the second level and third level. There is like a bunch of topics, but they are not connected. So it should be reorganized. order to improve this level of English. The characteristics of our students need to be taken into account at all levels in any educational programs. Sometimes we take that, as I said before, all of our students are the same, and their characteristics, the importance they give to English, the background, the educational background they have, it's very different. And we put the students in the classroom and we try to think that all of them are going to learn the same way. The UCC needs to invest money, time, and research to adapt a bilingual program that fits its necessities and priorities. You might probably, as we studied, you know that there is simultaneous bilingualism, balanced bilingualism, there are different types of bilingualism that need to be considered. Sometimes we cannot achieve, or it will be too pretentious to achieve balanced bilingualism. But we can, if we work and if we contextualize the program, we can achieve some kind of bilingualism in our institutions. First language training must be granted before thinking about teaching a second language. This is one of the biggest problems. Sometimes our students do not struggle with first language. They don't even know how to write or to write or to read correctly in Spanish. I have seen some of my students making mistakes in their first language, and we think that Spanish is already achieved, so we can move to English. And if we are talking about bilingualism, we know that we are talking about two languages, English and Spanish. I think this is the first thing that must be considered. Well, this presentation had some of the characteristics at the Universidad Cooperativa. I tried to show you some of the characteristics. I tried to show you the conditions in Pasto in Colombia for developing bilingualism, and the conditions here in Pasto and in Universidad Cooperativa for this bilingual program to be carried out. I hope it's okay. I apologize for not being able to be with you guys, and I hopefully see you next semester. Thank you very much.